A, we're going to be doing the session on novel predictive cardiac marker and its clinical significance by Dr. Shakti Agarwal. Dr. Shakti Agarwal is a senior biochemist at Clinical Reference Laboratory, SRL Diagnostics, Gurgaon. He's an alumnus of Lady Harding Medical College, from where he completed his MD in biochemistry in 2008. He has done extensive research on latent autoimmune diabetes in adults and role of C-peptide in latent diabetes, for which he has won the Best Paper Award at AMBI in 2007. He's also won the Travel Award at the 12th Asia Pacific Congress for Clinical Biochemistry for his poster on influence, atherosclerosis, and accession arterial, lipase activity. He has delivered lectures at many CMEs and conferences and has also many publications to his credit. May I please invite on stage Dr. Suvin to maybe felicitate him, please? Dr. Suvin, could I request you to come on stage and felicitate Dr. Shakti Agarwal? May I please request Dr. Agarwal to come on stage? My apologies in advance for the language that I get confused with. Medical jargon's not my strong suit, but all the best to you, Doctor.
Okay. A very good afternoon to all of you. As she introduced, I am Dr. Shakti Agarwal, and I'm working as senior biochemist with SRL Diagnostic, our Gurgaon reference lab. Today, I am going to talk about a novel predictive biomarker, fatty type, heart type fatty acid binding protein. As we all know, when we were in the medical college, acute chest pain is one of the most common presenting complaint when we are sitting in the emergency department of the medicine. Now, there can be a variety of acute chest pain. Some can be very trivial, like heartburn, and some can be extremely lethal, like acute coronary syndrome. If we talk about the statistics, I think acute coronary syndrome is one of the leading cause of the mortality all over the world. And even in the India, ACS, that is acute coronary syndrome, has got the highest burden throughout the world. So definitely it makes a huge sense that we should come up with a very robust and good biomarker that can help clinicians to evaluate acute coronary syndrome at a very early stage and definitely take the decision as per the demand of the situation. So if we look at this slide, we can see that our journey for an ideal biomarker for the heart has come a long way. If we see in the mid-90s, CK, that is creatinine kinase, was the only available biomarker. And then our hunt was on, CKMB was discovered, then myoglobin, and then so on. But FABP, heart type fatty acid binding protein, and that is FABP, is the most recent biomarker that has been added to this list. Now, what is FABP? As the name suggests, fatty acid binding protein, this is basically a small cytoplasmic protein which is present in those tissues or those organs where fatty acid metabolism takes place, like heart and liver. So as the name suggests, I told you this is a protein which helps in the intracellular transport of the long chain fatty acids. If we compare with all other biomarkers, you can see that this is the smallest in terms of molecular weight, and therefore it is known that there are so many studies have been done which shows that this is the first or the earliest biomarker which can be seen in the blood following the ischemic injury. Now in this slide, all of you can see that in the early phases of the ischemia, when there is a little cardiac myocyte stretching, the troponin T, which is shown in the blue dots, is unable to come out in the blood. But as I told you, FABP is the smallest in terms of the molecular weight and in terms of size, it can come out even in the initial phase of the ischemia. This is basically the release kinetics of the various biomarkers available in the market right now. You can see that myoglobin and FABP, they have got the similar kind of kinetics. Now, what is the difference between these two parameters? Myoglobin, if I remember, I still remember a lecture in my medicine classroom, that myoglobin was told to be the most sensitive marker available at any time of the time. Why? Because first of all, whenever we talk about any biomarker may be in case of ischemia, maybe in case of any other tumor marker, anything. Whenever we talk about the biomarker, the sensitivity is the first thing which we should look at. Now, what is sensitivity? Sensitivity is a negative predictive value. Means whenever the marker is negative, it means the disease should not be there. So myoglobin, it is the most sensitive marker till date, because if there is no myoglobin in the blood, it means there is no MI, no ischemia. But if it is positive, then does it take us anywhere? No, because myoglobin is present in skeletal muscles also. So sometimes it becomes very difficult to diagnose the cases on the basis of myoglobin. Now, if you talk about FABP, again, the sensitivity is much more, almost 100%, and even the specificity, if we compare the specificity of FABP with myoglobin, it is around 15 to 20 times more. So it makes, in that sense, it makes it almost ideal biomarker for ischemia. Another major merit of using FABP is it peaks at around 6 to 8 hours after the ischemia, and it comes down to the basal normal line at around 24 to 30 hours. So that makes it very peculiar, because if there is an episode of reinfarction or reperfusion injury, which typically takes place after 2 to 3 days, you will see 2 peaks of the FABP. Whereas CKMB and troponin I, which are the most used biomarkers, are unable to differentiate between the reinfarction and the original infarction. So this was about the basic overview of the FABP. Now, coming to the various studies where it has been established that FABP is a good or the best diagnostic marker as well as prognostic marker in case of ischemia. It's not moving. Okay. So this is the first study. This was done by McCann et al. And it was published in a very reputed journal, that is European Heart Journal, in 2008. It clearly shows, you can see, the authors have compared the sensitivity of detecting acute coronary syndrome using troponin T, FABP, in conjunction and alone. You can see the red line shows the sensitivity when we have used only FABP as the marker. The blue bar shows that only troponin T was used. And this green line, which stand tallest among all, is the case where both of them were used. So clearly it is clear that the sensitivity has been observed higher in all the time periods. Now, this is another similar study which was done by McMahon et al. And it was published in American Journal of Emergency Medicine in 2012, relatively new study. Again, the findings were similar, but they had used many more markers in their study. They had used different sets of the biomarkers and established the sensitivity. You can see again the red line, which shows troponin I and FABP were used in conjunction. They had got the best sensitivity with these two parameters. This is another similar study where this was done by Body R et al. And published in the Resuscitation 2011. In this, they have compared the various statistical parameters to compare the difference between, they had actually divided the patient into two subsets. In one subset, they had used the troponin I and FABP, and another subset, they had used the conventional biomarkers, that is CKMB, troponin I, and myoglobin. Now you can see the red line in which we had used, the authors had used FABP and troponin I, they had got the best results. You can see there is a significant difference between the sensitivity and specificity both. Now this all data which I have just shared with you, this was done in the foreign land, but now this is the some study has been done in India also. But obviously this study is not published yet, but this is done at Breach Candy Hospital. So I will just share the data that they have shared with us. Till date, the 88 patients have been enrolled in the study. Out of these patients, 51 patients were diagnosed with acute coronary syndrome and 37 patients were diagnosed with a non-ACS. If we slice the data, we found that out of 51 patients who were identified with having the ACS, 49 could be identified with the FABP alone. And if you compare with the TNI, if you compare with the high sensitivity TNI, this was, so this was the slide I was talking about. FABP was able to identify around 49 patients out of 51 positive cases of ACS. But if you compare it with the TNI, only 44 patients were identified. So clearly it is clear that FABP is better biomarker than TNI. Out of these 37 patients without ACS, FABP was positive in 9, and troponin I high sensitivity was positive in 4. In this case, you can see that specificity is little less than TNI. Therefore, we argue that it should not replace the TNI, rather it should be it should give best result when they are used together. So this is again the slice of the data of the Breach Candy study. We can see when using both the parameters together, we have achieved almost 100% sensitivity and 70% specificity, which is decent. So this is the summary of the Breach Candy study. If we combine the troponin I high sensitivity and FABP, they can offer almost 100% sensitivity and they have missed 0 cases of ACS. Troponin I high sensitivity and FABP can rule out all the cases of non-ACS. Now coming to a very interesting rule which was developed by Manchester College. This is a very interesting finding which has been published in a very journal of very repute, that is Heart, in 2014. In this, they had used 8 variables. They have covered 8 variables, and it is basically a risk stratification method, just like prenatal assessment screening, where we take demographic profile and some biochemical parameters, and then we give a score to the patient to identify them at a high risk or they are at the low risk. So in this all 8 variables, you can see that FABP is alone, that is an individual parameter, and it has been recently included. So based on these findings, we can identify the patient as the very low risk, moderate risk, or having the high risk. Okay, and this study has already been externally validated by some other studies. You can see the patients who were identified with a very low risk, they had a very low chance of developing acute MI and major adverse cardiac events. If you compare with the patients who were put into the high risk, they had a very high chance of developing AMI and MACE. So this is the conclusion of MACS rule, that rules have been successfully derived and externally validated also. FABP has been given an essential part of the rule. FABP was independently predictive of MACE with a high degree of statistical significance. And you can see that MACS rule, which had identified the 27% of patients in a very low risk, you can see there was a very low chance of developing MI or MACE, only 0% chance of developing MI and 1.6% of adverse effects in the long term. Now, this was about the diagnostic value. Now, coming to the FABP as a prognostic marker. Can we use it as a follow-up marker? Can we use it in the follow-up cases also? You can see this study was published by Kilcullen in American Journal of American College of Cardiology. You can see this red arrow is showing that the patients who had the initial high FABP and troponin was negative, even then the mortality rate was very high. And the patients who had the negative FABP and troponin was negative, there was almost nil chance of developing mortality. So basically, we can see that FABP is more sensitive marker for deciding the mortality in long term. If you are, even in this case, you can see both the troponin positive and FABP is positive, mortality was very high. So maybe these are the cases of unstable angina which were not basically diagnosed with using the troponin I. Because as I told you in the previous slides, troponin I is a little larger molecule. It is not able to come out in the early cases of ischemia or in case of unstable angina. But FABP, as I told you, this is basically released at a very early stage of the ischemia. So maybe these are the cases of unstable angina which are not diagnosed with troponin I, but can be easily diagnosed with the FABP. Again, this is a similar study which is showing you that FABP has got a role in the mortality, deciding the mortality. You can see in the top of the line, the red line, the patient who had the high FABP values and negative, although negative troponin, they had a very high mortality. This is another very good study which was published in Journal of American College of Cardiology. Heart type fatty acid binding protein predicts long-term mortality and reinfarction in consecutive patients with suspected acute coronary syndrome who were actually troponin I negative. Again, this is a similar study, but the authors had taken a cutoff of 6.32, which is the highest cutoff for the normal level of FABP. You can see the patient who had the high value of FABP compared to the cutoff. Cutoff is taken as 6.32. More than 6.32 had the death rate or MI rate very high. Now, this is another study in which the authors had compared the hazard ratio. Like you can see, the patients who are having high FABP value compared to low FABP had a very high hazard ratio. So this is a concluding remark. This is a line taken from the Journal of American College of Cardiology 2010, which is very reputed journal. They had demonstrated that the prognostic value of elevated FABP is additive to troponin I in low and intermediate risk patient with suspected ACS. So all studies basically, they tell us that maybe the FABP we are not saying that it is a replacement for all other cardiac markers, but probably if we use it in conjunction with troponin I, it will offer the highest sensitivity and even the good prognostic marker. So these are the expected values for the normal patients. If we take two standard deviation, the higher cutoff is 3.55, but if we include almost three standard deviation of the values, 6.3 is the highest cutoff for the normal patients. So the FABP is currently being done only by the Rendox laboratory. They have developed this assay. This is immunoturbidimetric assay, and it can be used on any clinical chemistry analyzer. These are the hospitals where currently FABP has been started, and many more are on the list. And this is a cartoon which is showing that this should not happen in the OT table after taking so much of pain in diagnosing acute coronary syndromes. Thanks a lot.
Dr. Agarwal, may I please request you to come back on stage? And if there are any queries, we still have some time. If there's anybody who'd like to put a question to Dr. Agarwal, this might be a good time.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. Specificity is definitely a concern with the FABP. Troponin I has got a very high sensitivity, around 97%. Trop T and Trop I. Trop T has got around 97%, and Trop I has got around 94% specificity. Almost similar, but FABP has got around 70% specificity if used alone. But in terms of sensitivity, it is a very good marker. And just as I compared with the myoglobin was also a very good marker in terms of sensitivity, but specificity was very pathetic. But in case of FABP, it is giving you a decent specificity of around 70 to 75%. Actually, when you are sitting in an emergency room, you don't want to over-treat the patient. You don't want to over-diagnose. So in those clinical scenarios, it is very important that you should have a very good marker with higher sensitivity so that you can at least rule out the normal cases. So in that way, FABP can prove beneficial.
Is anybody else who'd like to pose a question?
Any more question for Dr. Agarwal?
Approximately cost will be around 1,000 rupees, as told by Rendox people. I think they will be the right person to tell you the cost, but around 1,000 it will be there. And maybe if the load is more, then definitely we will cut down on the cost. Because relatively it is a very new marker, so currently the cost is little high.
being applicable in Delhi. FABP. We just wanted to, hello doctor, I'm actually from Delhi. Mm-hmm. I just wanted to know the implication of this if it is portrayed in Delhi market.
Definitely it should work. Actually it is not about any market, maybe Delhi or Bombay. It is the utility of the parameter. If we market it correctly and if, so definitely there is a scope.
And what about the validation and verification before we start on for implementation?
See, actually, currently the it has the guidelines. May this has not been yet included because the last guidelines from ACA, that is ACLS guidelines, were they had come in the 2010. So probably we are hoping that this will be included in the latest guideline, which is going to be released in early 2016 or late 2015. So if then it is included, then I think that will be very nice for you. All of us.
Yes, because like from your speech and your presentation, highly impressive. But since I come from Delhi and from a heart institute, I certainly would like certain type of these type of presentation to be more in the Delhi market scenario. Because if it is helpful, I think we can go ahead with that.
Yes, I think we will have to wait for some more time then, because I think the parameter, what do you mean by Delhi market? Actually, there is nothing difference between,
yeah,
you know,
exactly,
Delhi
yeah.
market and
yeah,
other market.
Yeah.
Market is almost same.
Yes.
The practice is almost same. Practice is followed on the same line everywhere. It is about the acceptability of the parameter. So parameter is currently, it is in the, it is a very novel marker and it is in the initial phase of its marketing. So definitely you will, we are not finding many guidelines. But the studies which I have shared with you, they are all they are published in a very reputed journal. So I think we can, in the Indian market also, we can start doing this and we can validate the test in-house.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Agarwal. It's still about 8 minutes to spare. Mark of an efficient yet an effective doctor.